Well, praise the Lord. It's good to be here once again. I'd like that we bow our heads and pray as we get ready for the Word of God. We bless you, King of the universe. We thank you, mighty and everlasting Father. We thank you in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Deliverer, that you touch our minds, that you touch our hearts, and that you prepare us, my God, to hear from you and hear from heaven for changes in our lives to take place. Because it is you that we depend on for lasting changes in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We all want progress in our lives. We want to see growth in our lives. Every parent, every mother, every father desires to see their children growing and developing and maturing and taking on responsibility. Presidents want to see growth in the economy of their countries. Everybody wants to see growth and development. Businessmen want to see their business is thriving, and nobody wants stunted growth. Nobody wants a situation where growth is not taking place. I have a word from the Lord that growth is assured. You may have noticed that things are not going the way you want them to go, but the Lord is giving us an assurance today that growth will certainly take place. At the individual level, you will have growth in your relationship with God. You will grow spiritually. You will develop and mature and become what God wants you to be. But you need to do the small little things. You need to make the small little baby steps in your life. If you want to develop spiritually, you must begin to take in God's word into your life. A scripture a day keeps the devil away. Amen. A scripture a day will ensure that you develop on a daily basis. You may not see the growth in an instant. Growth takes time, and growth grows slowly. Growth happens, you know not how. When you put seed in the ground, you do not go tomorrow to see whether it has started germinating and then sprouting and doing things like that. You give time to the seed. It will come up. And when it comes up and it's not rising up faster, as fast as you want, you don't pull it up. No, you let it do its natural thing. Growth will happen, but it will take time. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord our God. In the book of Mark's Gospel, chapter number 4 and the beginning scripture, verse number 30. And these parables Jesus gave because of the kingdom of God, because of the ministry that he was going to leave with his disciples. He gave them these parables so that they should not be discouraged when they notice that nothing seems to be happening, because something is always happening. Hallelujah. Amen. And verse number 30 to 32 is a passage of our study. And he said, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what comparison shall we compare it when it comes to growth? It is like a grain of mustard seed, he said, which when it is sown in the earth is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. But when it is sown, it groweth up and becometh greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. The kingdom of God is likened to the growth of a mustard seed into a mustard plant. Now, a mustard seed is a small little black seed. It's not like a bean seed. No, it's not like a corn or maize. No, it's very small. But when it grows, it becomes taller than a horse and his rider, or probably slightly higher than that. From a small little seed. When Jesus gave this parable, the Jews that were listening to him, his listeners, could easily recognize some two pictures. One of the pictures is the mustard seed itself, and the other one is when he talks about how the tree grows, the finality of the tree. You see, in Jewish culture, a grain of a mustard seed proverbially stood for the smallest possible thing. The smallest possible thing. And in the Old Testament, great empires were described as trees with branches and birds on those branches. The tributary nations were seen as birds that were hanging onto that tree and feeding from that tree, getting protection from that tree. And Jesus is talking about the kingdom of God. Jesus is talking about how that we should not be discouraged because of stunted growth or slow growth. One of the first lessons that we get out of this parable is that never be intimidated by small beginnings. Never be daunted by small beginnings. Never be startled. Never worry about there not appearing to be growth and development in whatever you are doing. Especially if you are doing the work of God. You may not see that your efforts are making any impact or that there is effect in the little things that you are doing in the kingdom of God, in the work of God. But don't you be startled by that. Don't you be discouraged by that. Don't you be intimidated by that. Because small, little things that you do in the work of God, slowly by slowly, they will bring a big impact. Hallelujah. You see, drop by drop, the die is dropped. I say drop by drop, a die is dropped into clear water. And when you drop that die, it does not seem to have any effect on the water. Then you drop the second one. It doesn't seem like it is going to be. And you drop, drop, drop. And as you look at that clear water, it looks like an effort in futility. It looks like nothing is gonna change. But as you continue dropping that die, drop by drop, suddenly you see a tinge of color. The entire body of clear water starts to change. It picks the color of the dye. And then you notice that something has been happening, although it was happening slowly. Hallelujah. Slowly by slowly, the effect will be felt. If there is someone that you are witnessing Jesus to, if there is someone you are witnessing this gospel and this salvation to, don't you give up. Go back again. Tell them one more word. Go back again. Tell them one more sentence. Go back again. Display the faith before them. Go back again. You never know. You probably have one more time to go. And when you just drop that final word, that person is going to turn. Research has shown that in marketing, in sales, the greatest percentage of deals are struck after the 10th visit. You go the first day, they slam the door. You go the second day, they ask you, I thought you were here the other day. Don't you give up. Go the third time, go the fourth time, go the fifth time. Don't you give up. Perseverance is all that you need. Do it again. Hallelujah. Don't you give up. Don't you give up. Small, little, repeated actions will bring the changes that you desire. One more prayer. Hallelujah. One more prayer will bring you closer to the goal than you can ever imagine. One more effort in the Lord's work will bring you closer to achieving and completing the mission that God has given to you than you can ever realize. Everything must have a beginning. And Zechariah told us, despise not, Zechariah 4:10, despise not the day of small beginnings. Verse number 10, he says, and who have despised the day of small things? It may take a while, but it's just a day of small things. Every great kingdom began small. Every great rebellion starts small. Every good thing starts small. The church must start small. Whether it is this church or whether it is the very ministry of Jesus Christ himself. The kingdom of God began with one man. Hallelujah. It began with one man. And he called Peter. He called Andrew. He called John. He called James. There were five. Before long, he called Matthew. Before long, he called Nathaniel under a fig tree somewhere. And they were a small team of 13 people. And by the time of Pentecost, there were about 120 people. You would have thought in 3.5 years, Jesus would have 5,000 people, or 10,000, or maybe 1 million people, because of his contact and relationship with God. But no, it wasn't like that. But do you know we are part of that team? Do you realize that we are part of that team that began with one man, 5 people, 12 people, 72 people, 120 people, 500 people? How many are we now? How many Christians do we have? Nothing emerges full grown. Things must grow. Things must develop. And sometimes the longer time is taken in foundation, the stronger the structure and the building. Praise the name of the Lord our God. It is our particular duty. It is our individual duty to continue doing the little thing that is our duty to do. Don't ask how many people are doing what I am doing. Be concerned with what the Lord has commanded you to do. Be faithful in your calling. Don't worry about me. I'm worried about me. Worry about yourself and your obedience to the Lord. If there is a discussion that we should have, it should be, can you confirm whether what I am hearing is from the Lord? If there is any conversation that we should have between us, is to be finding out, what is it that the Lord wants me to do? What is it that the Lord wants you to do? What is it that the Lord created you for? What is God's investment that he made in your life? What is God's calling for you? That should be the greatest conversation between us. Our duty, your duty, my duty is to do what I can do, is to do what God wants me to do, and do it as quickly as possible, because no one knows tomorrow. Don't worry about the results. The results will come. They may come in your lifetime, or they may not come in your lifetime, but sure they will come. There are some parents that taught their children the principles of God, and they never lived to see their children doing those things and following those principles, because probably they died. But the children have picked them, they keep remembering what their parents told them, and they go in the way that they were taught and the foundation that was laid in their lives, or the days of their lives. You may go into the market and start preaching and speaking the gospel, and nobody may come and respond positively to that message, but you have sown the seed. And the Spirit of God will grab hold of that seed and will ensure that that seed never goes down to the drain. You never know what's going to happen to the people that have heard the gospel when you preach, or the message when you preach. There could have been in that meeting a future Billy Graham. I had many people speak to me about the Lord. Some of them spoke to me about the Lord, speaking to me, but like they are frightened. And I never accepted the Lord. I never came to the Lord straight like that. And I remember their names. And some of them went home discouraged, but they have planted the seed in my life. And one day, hallelujah, one day, alone in a room, the Holy Spirit of God started convicting me, and I accepted the Lord. Not just because the Spirit of God was speaking to me, but because there had been an investment into my life. That a word had been spoken by different people who probably went home discouraged that day, but God used that. And today, every time I speak the word, those people, they may not know, but they are the ones that are doing it. Because had they not spoken to me, I would not have probably come to the Lord. So don't you be discouraged by the appearance of you not having results, of growth not seeming to happen. This parable of the mustard seed speaks of the empire of the church. The empire of the church. You see, Jesus, verse number 32. But when it is sown, it groweth up and becometh greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. If you quickly turn to Daniel chapter number 4 and verse number 10. Talking about Belteshazzar, verse 9. Oh, Belteshazzar, master of the magicians, because I know that the spirit of the holy gods is in thee, and no secret troubleth thee, Tell me the visions of thy dream that I have seen and the interpretation thereof. Verse 10. Thus were the visions of mine head in my bed. I saw and behold a tree in the midst of the earth, and the height thereof was great. Can continue reading. But in verse number 20, it says, the tree that thou sawest, which grew and was strong, whose height reached unto the heaven, and the sight thereof to all the earth. Verse 21. Whose leaves were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and in it was meat for all, under which the beast of the field dwelt, and upon whose branches the fowls of heaven at their habitation. It is thou, O king, and thou art grown and become strong, for thy greatness is grown and reacheth unto heaven, and thy dominion to the end of the earth. Jesus spoke about the parable of the mustard seed, and then said it grows to be a tree, and the branches spread up abroad, across, and birds of the air lodge under the shadow of it. The kingdom of Babylon was an expansive kingdom. Spread, it was a great, mighty kingdom. And the world wondered at the power of that kingdom. But the kingdom of God is going to be greater than the kingdom of Babylon. The church is going to reach every part of this earth. The church is going to be the only place where the entire world will have hope in. So, if we are talking about the empire of the church, what is the message for us as citizens of this kingdom? Well, one, we must create room for others. Amen. We must create room for others. There are others coming. And we must not own the church to whereby when strangers come in, they feel like they are strangers. We must create room for them so that when they come in, they feel part and parcel of the church. Many times we have eyes, scrutinizing eyes. When we see people come, we want to scrutinize them. We want to evaluate them. Do they, have they come genuinely? Are they here genuine? No. Let me tell you something. We must create room in the kingdom of God so that when people come in, they feel they belong. This is a spirit that even Jesus had to deal with among his disciples. In Mark chapter 9 and verse number 38, and John answered him, saying, Master, we saw one casting out devils in your name, and he followeth not us. And we forbade him, because he followeth not us. The disciples of Jesus were not accommodative of other people that would use the name of Jesus Christ and not go with them. We stopped him, they told Jesus. And they thought they were going to get a promotion. We saw one casting out demons in your name. And because he didn't come with us, we forbade him. We told him, don't never use that name again. And Jesus said, verse 39, would you like to know what Jesus said? This is what Jesus said. And this is what Jesus is still saying today. He said, forbid him not. Don't stop him. Don't call him a stranger. For there is no man which shall do a miracle in my name that can lightly speak evil of me. For he that is not against us is on our part. You know what Jesus is telling these people? He told them, those people are with us. They are with us, although they have not come to go with us everywhere we are going. Are you able to see other people as God's people, even though they do not go with you? See, we easily label people as heretics. That's a heretic. Well, St. Augustine of Hippo is famed for this statement. In essentials, unity. In non-essentials, freedom or liberty. But in all things, charity. In other words, we need to know what is of greatest priority in our lives. What are the essential things that we must agree on? And then the rest, that's our freedom. And on that, Romans chapter number 14 comes in very handy. And read Romans chapter 14, not only in the King James Version, but also in other translations. We need to understand what is it that we must agree on, and what is it that we must give people freedom and liberty, even though they are under the same roof with us. Even here, with all the preaching and teaching and doctrinal explanations that I have given on this pulpit, there are still some people here that do not believe the same way I believe. And I've never changed you. And I know
what you believe in is not theologically sound or biblically sound. But you see, in essentials, unity. In non-essentials, liberty. But in all things, charity. If I start asking questions here, I will get different answers on some matters. Some matters biblical, but matters biblical that are not essential. Does it matter really whether you know who Moses' mother was? The name is written in the Bible, but you may not know it. Now, does that mean that you are not going to be part of the kingdom of God because you do not know Moses' mother? I know Moses' mother. I even know David's mother. It's not even written in the Bible, but I know. But that is a non-essential. But we need to understand the doctrine of sin. We need to understand repentance. We need to understand what sanctification is and holiness and some of these things. But there are even some details about those things that we don't necessarily need to know. But there are some essential things that we must agree on. Many of us do not know about prophecies about the future. But that does not stop you from being a child of God. Hallelujah. John Wesley used to say, "We think we should let think. I think I should let think. We think we should let think." In other words, if I have a right to think, should other people not have a right to think also? We must create room for others. Luke chapter number 9. Jesus dealing with his disciples. Chapter number 9, verse number 51. "And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face. And they went and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him." Verse 53. "And they did not receive him because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John, the sons of Zebedee, saw this, they said, 'Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elijah did?'" Lord, what? Don't you give us permission? We call on fire from heaven and destroy these ones. Verse 55. "But Jesus turned and rebuked them and said," what? You don't even know what kind of a demon has gotten into you. You don't even know what manner of spirit you are of. That which is making you react to people like that is not from God. You don't even know what kind of a spirit you are of. Verse 56. We must understand as a church why we exist and why Jesus came. The Son of Man. Because the Son of Man is not come to destroy man's life, but to save them. We must, and listen to this very carefully, my dear brethren. We must allow what and who the love of God allows. We must befriend who God is befriending. We must allow those God is allowing. We must allow into the church those that Jesus is allowing to the church. Jesus should not be putting into the church and we cast out of the church. We must be in sync with God. Whenever the Spirit of God draws somebody to the house of God, we should be there with all our hands welcoming them. Hallelujah. Because the kingdom of God must grow. The church is set for growth. God is going to bring growth to his work. We will not remain small. The church will not remain small. The kingdom of God will not remain small. We must allow and be ready to welcome people, even from other religions, because finally, this tree, finally this kingdom, finally, this empire of God is going to cover the world as the waters cover the sea. Hallelujah. From the end of the earth to the end of the earth. I remember the words of that prophet. He says, "And the knowledge of God shall cover the earth. The word of the Lord, it shall come a time when no one will teach his brother, nor the Lord, but they shall know the Lord from the least to the greatest, from the blackest to the whitest, from the blue one to the yellow ones. All of us are destined." Finally, those that the Spirit of God will touch will be in the kingdom of God. And you must be ready to welcome and to embrace them. Another prophecy says, "And they shall hold the skirt of a Jew and tell him, 'Lead us to Jerusalem, for we have heard that the Lord is with you.'" We must allow what and who the love of God allows.
I have in the past given you the story of three American soldiers during the Second World War in France. Three comrades, very close friends. They were fighting in France during the Second World War, and one of them was shot dead. And the two requested from their senior, please allow us to go and give our brother a Christian burial deserving to him. We don't want to bury him in the field. And they were given permission and they went to a lonely French church, which had a cemetery. They knocked the doors of that church and an old priest stooped on the back, asked them, what can I do for you? It was in the evening. They explained that their friend had died. And they were requesting that if they could bury him in the church cemetery because he was a Christian. And the priest said, sorry, but I will have to ask you a question. They said, go ahead, sir. He said, was your friend a Catholic? They said, no, he wasn't Catholic. So the old priest said, in that case, we cannot bury him in our cemetery. It's only for the Catholic saints. Discouraged, disappointed, they went just outside the fence of the church and buried their friend and went back. The following day, they were supposed to be moving forward, but they came very early in the morning to say bye-bye to their dead comrade. And when they came back, they couldn't see the fresh grave of their comrade. And they went knocked the same door again and said, sir, you remember last night we came, we buried our friend here. And we cannot see his grave. The old man said, when I went to sleep, I couldn't sleep. I tossed on my bed. I tried to think of how you love your brother. And I came out in the night and I moved the fence and I included your friend in the church compound. He is now inside. God has moved the fence and has included you. God has moved the fence and included us. It's time for us now to move the fence and include the other people in. Could be someone you have not forgiven and you feel like, I cannot forgive this person. Well, God wants you to move the fence and include them in. Because he moved the fence and put you in the compound. There are no barriers in the church of God. And if there were any, God and Jesus have moved those barriers. Let's not create any more barriers between us and God's people. The church must grow. Growth is assured. But we must not erect barriers. We must not build barriers between us and those that God has brought in. Praise his wonderful name. I just want us to pray. But as I pray, I want you to think of someone that you have shut outside. You feel they are not within your group. You don't consider them any longer as a brother or as a sister. It's time to forgive them. You don't have to go and explain to them what forgiveness really is. No, you show them what forgiveness is by forgiving them and accepting them and allowing them to come in. God has accepted you, though you were a sinner. Romans chapter 5 and verse number 8. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Let us break the barriers. Let us move the fence. Let us include within our region other brothers and sisters, people that love the Lord. Let's also love them because they belong just like us. Precious Father, in the name of Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. Lord, help us, my God, to learn and to understand the reality of your love in our lives. And that we may accept other people into the family of God. Because the church must grow. And when the church grows, it must engulf more of God's people. And some of them are people that we have been having problems with. But as the love of God engulfs them in, give us grace to accept one another and to see one another as brother and sister. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.